Olá. Bom dia.
Welcome to Brazil.
The place where
everybody is different
and the same.
The country where
we aim to have
free health care
for me,
for you,
for us,
for everyone.
Pela avenida toda iluminada, amanhã os blocos vão passar e o meu amor vai desfilar. Só vendo meu amor sorrindo, ganhando aplausos da multidão, sem saber que estão
Yes, my name is Ulysses Peneset, and I'm an adjunct professor at the Federal University of Minas Gerais at the School of Medicine. I still have a very vivid memory of the bus station where people would take their buses from this neighborhood to work downtown, and the military police on horses and swords, like in the 19th century, just, getting people on the lines and into the buses like cans of sardines, totally dehumanized. And yeah, well, at the time of the military dictatorship in Brazil, the health system was completely different from now. Only people, and this was, of course, a huge contradiction, only people who were employed had the right to health care, to free health care, by the government. And this was within a whole process of a retirement insurance as well. But only for people who were workers that had their, their documents signed. So most of the population was left out of any health care, except for philanthropic healthcare. So this and some campaigns of vaccination and issues like that. So we have come a long way since then. SUS, as we call the Sistema Único de Saúde, was in our constitution of 1988, which was the constitution after those many years of military dictatorship, in which it was really written in stone that health is a right of every Brazilian citizen, and it's a duty of the state to provide health care. So, and at the same time, the SUS was organized also in a way that it focused on health promotion, on health prevention, and rehabilitation and health care. And at the same time also, it's based on the principle of equity. So it's that people who need more will receive more. Also, I would like to stress two very important points about the SUS. And one is that it's open and free to everyone. So another feature of the SUS that I think it's worth mentioning, because it's crucial to understand, and it's also designed by law, that it's extremely decentralized. We have populations of from 10,000 to 20,000 people, and they are divided by zones according to the risk they have. But this is the risk in terms of health. So the most vulnerable populations, the populations that are more vulnerable to social determinants of health, such as education, nutrition, income, and also transportation, housing, those including also some risks in terms of security, of personal security and crime. So those areas that are considered more vulnerable, they will receive more resources, including they will have more community health agents working in that area, doing house visitation, promoting vaccination, and also promoting health in the sense of education, and working with schools, especially at elementary schools. Those community health agents, they are recruited from the community itself. So they have a regular job, and they are the eyes and the ears and the words of the health centers for each one of the communities. So it's a treasure. This is invaluable because they see the reality and they help the health professionals to really be able to relate better and to understand the reality and the health challenges at the local level.
Well, I'm Galton. I'm a pediatric ophthalmologist. I'm a professor of ophthalmology here at the Universidade Federal de Minas Gerais. To talk a little bit about the SUS, it's a reasonably young system. Now it's dated from the late 80s, so it's now 20, 25 maybe years old. It was created to offer services, health services to all the population, being very inclusive, being universal for everybody, doesn't make any differentiation in anything. So it's a system, it's a health system for everybody. So as Brazil is very big, there are many, many challenges to keep this system working, to offer the best quality services for everybody. The original text that created the SUS, the law of SUS, was very well done. But of course, at that time, at the end of the 80s, it could not predict how big it would become, the SUS system, how expensive it would cost. And as along the course of the medicine advancements, like technological images and new drugs and treatments, it's not cheap to keep all those treatments included in the hall of the procedures that SUS offers to the population. So nowadays it costs much more to offer the same system than before. And each year, the annual cost is getting bigger and bigger. The original text says that you will be offered all the treatments. So when you say all the treatments, it would include all the sophisticated new treatments and challenges. It means people go to the court to claim for the treatments, the new treatments and drugs that are being offered around the world.
So it happened 2 years ago. A child with, I don't remember what was her disease. She has the indication for 5 transplants, organ transplants. And someone in US could do it. Mm-hmm. So the family sued the system, got the money to go to US. The doctor did 5 transplants on the same time.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And what happened? The child died.
Yeah.
Her name was Sophia. Died. Mm-hmm. So the system paid for everything.
Of course, we need money to keep the system, and the investments are lower, and the costs are higher, and so this is something to be worked on, like the balance in between costs and expenses. And but I believe Brazil has a very interesting characteristic. We're very flexible. And sometimes this works. Sometimes we don't know why it works, but it works. And I believe that we are going to have a much better system in the future.
Hi, I'm Gabriela Ruiz. I'm 23 years old. I'm a medical student my fourth year at Universidade Federal de Minas Gerais. SUS, the current healthcare system in Brazil, is a unified system. It is for everyone, so I think it's a great theory that you can have multiple care in every aspect of health, but in practice it's not as much as we think. So as a public university, you get to see inside the public health system, the SUS, and explore every level of it, the first, the second, the third level of it, but you don't get access as much to much technologies that you have in Europe or the United States, because it's public money, so sometimes we don't have access to the most expensive treatments because of that. Brazil has been through a big political crisis lately, and I think it has been affected as public universities, and with difficulties with money and with supplies, and really the administrative area of it has been like with a crisis as well. Because everything is public, so everything is connected. So when the point in the top falls down, everything starts to tremble. So here, I think that changing the government, the party and the sides and right and left, so I think it's going to affect more and more each time until everything established now. No, right point.
It's a small minority that controls the media, that is now controlling the government. In this highest income percentile of the population, orchestrated, especially in the past 3-4 years, a coup d'etat that was very different from anything we experienced before. And I think that anything that even the world has experienced, because it was extremely well planned by the current president, Mr. Michel Temer, who was the deputy president. And If you look at the polls now, he has less than 14% of popularity in the country and no votes. The current political crisis in Brazil is probably one of the main threats that the SUS has experienced in all its 30 years history. Yesterday, which was 11th of October, we had this approval of this measure that will put a very rigid ceiling on the spending for education and health. And I think that this, we are going to pay an enormous social price for this if this is not changed. If we don't deal with this, and if we don't have very wise policies to confront the situation, you know, the health is going to deteriorate very fast. And that's my main concern. So from a success story, we will become a terrible story in the sense of the health situation. And I hope I'm wrong. And in the long term, one of my main concerns is not only in terms of purely of public health, but what this represents also in terms of social peace in Brazil. Because those huge changes and this, you know, going back this way, is not going to be accepted. For me, the unified health system is more than Brazilian. I think, I again dare to say that it's a patrimony of the humanity. And so, I think we have to reflect about that and what are we going to do with the health of people in the world. And we can, we have the means, we have the technology, we have the research, not only in Brazil, but globally, to fix so many issues that we are neglecting. In global health, when you have an imbalance in one part, it affects other parts as well. So I think that this has to be seen not only as a Brazilian problem, as a bad phase that we're going through, but as something that has an impact to in other countries, not only our neighbors in Latin America. But I would say that it has an impact globally.
Gonna make a change for once in my life. It's gonna feel real good. Gonna make a difference. Gonna make it right. As I turn up the collar on my favorite winter coat, this wind is blowing my mind. I see the kids in the street. Not enough to eat. Who am I to be blind, pretending not to see their need? A sonorous disregard, a broken.